In this tutorial, I'm going to show you three basic hatching methods you can use to render your drawings in pen and ink. These are very well-known techniques that have been used by many artists in the past. So I'll demonstrate how to do them, and then after each method, I'll show you an example of how one master artist used this technique to create their drawing. Before we begin, though, I think it's very important to talk about what elements in a drawing create the illusion of three-dimensional form. This is a topic commonly known as light logic. Here's a quick charcoal sketch that I did of a sphere. Let's take a look at what components make the sphere appear as three-dimensional. So first, a little bit of terminology. The lighter part of the sphere is simply called the light. And then we have two kinds of shadows we're dealing with. We have a body shadow. Body shadow is a shadow that sits on the body of the object. And then we have a cast shadow. A cast shadow is a shadow cast by objects onto other objects. Another very important piece of terminology. The separation between our lights and our body shadows is something called the light break. That's where the light stops and the shadow begins. On this sphere, you can see the light break has this kind of crescent shape. Now, the position of the light break is not precise because here we have a soft transition, so exactly where the light break stops and ends is not always clear on an object, but we can see its approximate location right about here. Okay, now that we understand that we're dealing with three big sectors when we're shading an object, let's talk about the three properties of light, the three properties of body shadows, and the three properties of cast shadows, starting with the light. The lighter area of the sphere has three characteristics, three things that need to be there in order for the lighter area to look convincing. The first thing is that the lighter area needs to have a highlight, the brightest value. That's going to be this value right here, A. And then everything outside of the highlight is simply called the light. So that's going to be B, the area here. Now recognize that on a sphere, the light is comprised of lots of different values, starting from the lightest light, working over to the light, and then a slightly darker light until it hits the shadow. Then we're going to have a gray area called the halftone. So the halftone is a gray area right before the lighter area transitions into the shadow. Now technically speaking, the halftone belongs neither to the light nor the shadow. It's this kind of twilight area in between where the form is at approximately 90 degrees from the light source, neither fully in light nor fully in shadow. So in order for the light to feel convincing, to feel three-dimensional, we need to have a highlight, a light, and a halftone. Without it, the light area is going to appear flat. Now let's discuss the body shadow. The body shadow also has three important properties that make it look like what it is, a body shadow. Number one, and this is most important, the body shadow needs to have a soft transition. So there needs to be a gradual feather transition between the shadow and the lighter area. If that transition is too abrupt, our form is going to feel blocky. It's going to feel angular, not round. So first important property of body shadow is that it has a fuzzy edge. The second important property is that there's going to be a darker value running along the light break, which is called a core shadow. So notice it's not the same value all the way through. Some places where the core shadow might be a little bit darker, it might get a little bit lighter towards the bottom here, but it needs to be there once again in order for the form to appear as three-dimensional. Last important property of body shadow is that there's going to be a lighter value at the edge of the shadow here and also here, depending on how much other light there is in the room. That's something called the reflected light. So light is hitting the light area of the sphere, but then it's also hitting the stand and partially reflecting back into the shadow. Again, without the reflected light, the shadows are going to appear flat, not 3D. So once again, if I want to create a convincing body shadow, I want to create a convincing illusion of a body shadow, I need to make sure that I check off the three properties here: fuzzy edge, core shadow, and reflected light. Now let's turn our attention to the cast shadow. Cast shadow also has three important properties that make it look like a cast shadow. Notice that the edge of the cast shadow is sharp. And then, as it moves away from the casting object, it gets fuzzier. This is highly dependent on your light source. So if you're using some kind of diffused fluorescent light, or we're dealing with some kind of sphere in an overcast day, In that case, the shadows are going to be fuzzy. So here we're dealing with a sharp incandescent light situation, or strong sunlight. Okay, so cast shadow is going to start sharp, then it's going to start fuzzing out, and then, also really important, cast shadows usually are darker at the point of origin, and then, depending on how much secondary light there is, so other light bouncing off the walls, other parts of the room, it's going to get lighter. So again, for a cast shadow to feel convincing, it needs to have some kind of edge transition. So even if it starts soft, it's going to end up even softer. And then it needs to start dark and end up lighter. Without it, if the shadow edge is sharp all the way through, or really fuzzy all the way through, has the same softness all the way through, and doesn't have some kind of value transition, it's not going to create a convincing illusion of cast shadow. Understanding light logic is very, very important, because quite often things get confusing, and unless you understand what you're drawing, right? Okay, I'm drawing a light, and understand what properties need to be there in order to create a convincing illusion, it's quite often you'll go wrong. Quite often you'll make a mistake. It goes back to a principle that I often repeat in my videos. You have to truly understand something well in order to draw it. This is why artists that specialize in the figure spend years, actually the entire artistic career, studying anatomy in order to understand what they're drawing better. This is why often landscape painters study meteorology to understand how clouds work. Good landscape painters understand the properties of trees, right? How light reflects off water. By developing an understanding of what you're drawing, you end up drawing it better. Okay, so now that we have some understanding of light logic, let's see how this translates to the technique of cross-hatching. It's going to be a little bit tricky. We're not dealing with charcoal, we can't blend, we can't smear, but in the next part of this video, I'm going to show you three different ways you can create an illusion of soft transitions, coarse shadows, reflected lights, using pen and ink, using cross-hatching. Okay, now let's talk about the three main methods of using hatching to create the illusion of three-dimensional form. We're going to start off with the single-directional method, which is probably going to be the easiest one and very good training for our other two, which are going to be a little bit more complicated. We're going to start off by first drawing the sphere, of course, and then, really important, indicating the location of the light break and the position of our highlight, and also the shape of our cast shadow. These are things that I do not want to be thinking about as I'm hatching. That's going to be very, very important. Now, I'm going to start off by drawing in, by hatching in, my core shadow. So the core shadow is going to be the darker value here. Why do I do that? Because the core shadow follows the shape of the light break and helps define the light break. So I'm going to start off with a single direction, and I'm going to stay with that direction. So let's make the hatching at the beginning 45 degrees. So we're going to stay with that. I notice that the core shadow is a little bit wider towards the middle of the sphere and a little bit narrower towards the edge. The most important thing is to stay with the same direction, and also, even more important, to stay with the same density. To stay with the same density of hatch, meaning that you want to keep the width of your hatching the same all the way through your drawing. All right, next step is to fill in the entire body shadow. When I do that, though, I want to put the body shadow a little bit past the light break. That's going to give the impression that we're dealing with a halftone here. So it's going to look like this. Now, my strokes here, because I'm using my wrist, my fingers, to create the marks, is going to be relatively short. I'm not going to be able to cover the entire area of the sphere all at once. Work in patches. So I'm going to push past the light break here. And then, to fill in the rest of the shadow, I just move down and fill it in. If you hold your fingers way back on the pen, it's going to allow you to create a slightly longer stroke. This is going to feel a little bit patchy at the beginning. However, we're going to put a number of layers on top of this. Towards the end, the patchwork is going to disappear. You're not going to see it quite as much. This type of hatching is a little bit less clean than the other methods. Right? It creates a slightly more irregular surface, which is why I recommend, if you're going to use this method, to use a thinner pen. So this is better for a fine, extra fine, it tends to create a stronger illusion of value, right? The lines from a distance kind of fuse together and create lights and darks. Okay, so here I notice that the core shadow needs to go a little bit darker. I'm just going to apply another layer here. And I can vary the line thickness. So in this case, I can press down a little bit harder to put down a slightly darker line. What I'm not going to vary is the direction or the density of the stroke. I'm always trying to keep those the same. Okay, so let's fill in a little bit more of our body shadow here. I notice that it's going a little bit darker towards this corner, towards the edge of the sphere. I can do that. And again, the more layers you put down, the more regular your shading's going to become. Right? The less patchy it's going to look. The core shadow here probably needs to go a little bit darker. Keep applying layer upon layer of line, and little by little, it's all going to kind of fuse together into value. This method is very, very good for artists that are beginning their cross-hatching journey. It teaches you to keep your lines straight and keep the density the same, which takes a lot of practice. If I want, I can extend my halftone a little bit as well. Let's do that. Okay, and now let's push into our cast shadow. So what are the properties of cast shadows? Cast shadows are sharp at the beginning. So I'm going to make the ends here abrupt. And then as they move away, I'm going to let the lines kind of trail off a little bit. So you see how I ended the lines here abruptly? Here they're getting thinner. Right? How do I do that? By lifting up as I move. You see how the line gets thin? If I stop and lift up, that creates a dash. Make sense? Boom, boom, dash, dash, lift up, lift up, lift up, lift up, creates little pointy tips. Right? So see how this edge feels sharp? Because here I stopped abruptly and then picked up. Here I picked up as I was moving. And trying as much as possible to keep the density the same, but pressing down harder so that I get a thicker line. So we haven't talked about different pens in this tutorial. I have other tutorials to deal with this. Some pens will allow for line variation, will allow you to increase the thickness of the line based on the pressure. Some don't. Some pens, when you flip the nib upside down, will create a thinner line. It always helps to have a pen that allows for that kind of stuff. Okay, so let's go a little bit darker here. Okay, I'm not saying I'm done here, obviously not, but you can see that I've created a fairly strong illusion of form. Why? Because I've checked off the properties of body shadow. I've got a soft transition, I've got a core shadow, I've got a reflected light, and I've checked off the properties of cast shadow. Darker and sharper towards the point of origin, and then softer, fuzzier and lighter as it moves away. Quite often, you'll see the pen and ink drawings are finished up to this point, that the lighter area is left alone. However, if I want to continue this, the next step would be to work on the light, to separate the highlight from the light, to separate a few different values in the light, and then to get the halftone, which we already have a little bit, but we need more of. For this, I recommend using a thinner pen. So right now, I'm using a medium nib. I'm going to switch to an extra fine for this process. For the simple reason, the values here need to be very light. They need to be very soft. I'm probably not going to be able to achieve that effect using a medium nib. Okay, so let's do it. We're going to separate the highlight from the light here. Again, keep the distance the same. I'm using a thinner line here, but the direction is the same and the density of line is the same. You can see that this method, first of all, it can achieve very nice results. It can, it's capable of that, but it's also very good practice. This is a really good way to get familiarized, to train your hand to hatch. So even if ultimately you're not going to be using this technique, this is always a good starting point. All right, now let's apply another layer of value. What are we doing? Okay, we separated the highlight from the light. Now let's start separating the lightest light from the general light, the sort of average light. Again, work in patches. The lightest light is here. And then as the sphere little by little turns away from the light source, it's going to get a little bit darker. A little bit. And now we're going to apply a little bit of halftone here, just to get that transition to go softer. Speed up here a little bit. Now, one thing I've noticed, and this is something that often happens, once you start shading the light, you realize that, wait a second, your shadow isn't going quite dark enough. So quite often, you're going to have to bounce back into the shadow. Let's go a little bit darker here. A little bit darker here. Now that I've got a darker value in the light, you can see that the shadow probably needs to go a little bit darker. And then I'm going to make fine little adjustments to the reflected light with my fine tip pen, just to go a little bit darker here. Okay, so that is the single direction method. I recommend you start with it, even if ultimately you want to do other types of hatching. It's the easiest one, and it's going to train your hand to create regularly spaced lines going whatever direction you want. And here is just about the most famous adherent of the single direction hatch method, Leonardo da Vinci. This is a little tiny drawing in the J. Paul Getty Museum. You can see that all of his hatching is going one way, though there are a few places where he's cross-contouring. So for instance, there's a slight change in angle at the shoulder. But mostly he's building up his values through really fine layers of single directional hatch. Our next rendering method is very similar to the single direction method, the only difference being that instead of applying a line of a single direction, I'm going to change the angle of my hatch every time I put down a new layer. So once again, I've indicated my light break, I've indicated the position of the highlight and the cast shadow, and now I am ready to start my hatching. We're going to start off with a hatch that once again represents the core shadow. This hatch could be any direction you want. It really doesn't matter. So I'll start off with a direction that's comfortable for me, about 45 degrees. Again, notice that the core shadow is a little bit narrower towards the sides and starts widening a little bit towards the center of the sphere. Once again, I'm concerned with maintaining the consistency of direction, and also maintaining the same density all the way through the hatch. All right, now that I've indicated the core shadow, I'm going to lay down the area of body shadow, except this time, instead of applying a hatch of the same direction, I'm going to change the angle. When you change the angle, it's really important to think about how much. If the angle shift is too slight, it's going to create a kind of interference pattern that's going to look like this. So let's say the angle shift is less than 10 degrees. Watch what happens. Do you see that the value is a little bit darker at the intersections and a little bit lighter in the holes? Right? That creates a slightly irregular effect. So you want to change the angle by about 15 degrees every time you apply another layer. So that's going to keep the little diamond shapes a little bit shorter and prevent this kind of interference pattern from occurring. So let's change the angle. And then, once again, I want to make sure that I push. For some reason, my pen is not writing. Let me see if I can clean it a little bit. I'm going to push my shading, my hatch, slightly past. Slightly past my body shadow. Okay, now once again, we're working in patches here. Let's see if I can clean up my pen a little bit here. Okay, and then every layer, maintain the same direction. Maintain the same direction. Maintain the same density. That's what I'm trying to do. Now, if the stroke widens a little bit, not a problem. Right? If it looks a little bit patchy at this stage, also not a problem. We're going to apply multiple layers. We're going to apply lots and lots of layers, and then little by little, the hatching is going to appear smoother. Now, again, the trick, every time I apply another layer, I have to change the angle. Now, you can rotate your wrist. There's some angles that are more comfortable than others. The easiest way of doing this, however, is just to rotate your paper slightly so that you're not forced to change the angle of the wrist, but just rotating the paper. So, what needs to happen? I need to reinforce the core shadow a little bit. I need to go a little bit darker in the body shadow a little bit. Let's change the angle and keep the lines straight. I'm not thinking about contour right now. So even though our sphere is round, we're going to keep the lines straight. Now, generally speaking, straight lines on a round form are not recommended. Right? Straight lines on a round form are going to give the impression of flatness. However, because we've got lots and lots and lots of these kind of straight intersecting lines, after a couple of layers, they're going to start sitting flat. They're going to start appearing not like straight lines, but again, they're going to create the illusion of value. So don't worry at the beginning if, oh my goodness, this doesn't look like it's turning the form. It doesn't have to. It doesn't have to. That's not the objective right now. All you need to think about right now is just make sure that you maintain the same density. Again, you can change the thickness of the line, so you can press down a little bit. I can do that, definitely, but I'm trying not to curve my lines, and I'm trying not to change the width of my lines. Again, that's going to create a stronger impression that we're dealing with value and not with texture. Let me outline my object a little bit. Okay, and keep changing the angle. All right, so let's push my half tone a little bit. All right, so we're going to push past slightly this way, like this. Keep things the same. Keep the width the same. You can see we've got a coarse shadow. We have half tone. We even have some sensor reflected light here. Keep going. Keep applying value until you have the appropriate contrast. So we need to go a little bit darker here. Going this way. We probably need to go a little bit darker here, like this. Now, ideally, for this type of hatching to remain clean, you want to apply probably no more than 8 different angles. Maybe even 6 is a little bit better, right? At a certain point, you've got so many different angles, you stop seeing the little boxes, right? Things get kind of jumbled. Don't worry about that at the beginning, right? That shouldn't be an issue. Really, the idea here is to build up the values until you've got the appropriate contrast. Try to change directions every single stroke, but if occasionally you miss and you put down a layer of the same direction, it's not that big a deal. It's not a problem. Okay, so now let's start dealing with our cast shadow. You know, usually I put down the cast shadow fairly early into the drawing, so I don't wait to finish one object before I start rendering its shadow. Okay, so here I want to make sure that I trail off, right, that my lines fade out a little bit. Let's change the angle. Again, I'm not concerned with the direction right now. I'm just concerned with maintaining the same density. I can make the lines a little bit lighter here, like this. Okay, let's change the angle one more time and let's get a little bit more density in our core shadows. Let's go this way. We haven't done this direction yet. Okay, you can see I'm not finished with the drawing in the light, but I have enough there to create the illusion of form because, once again, I've got a coarse shadow, I've got a soft edge, I've got some sense of reflected light. The cast shadow is sharper and darker at the beginning. And lighter as it moves away, and fuzzier as it moves away. Right? Okay. But we're still not done with the light. So if I want to get a little bit more rendering, then I need to switch to a lighter pen and start applying value to separate my highlight from my light. Again, I recommend using a finer nib for this purpose. Keep the density the same. Don't worry about direction. Again, we're treating the hatching as if it's washes of value. So think kind of like watercolor. One wash, to go darker, another wash, so long as the hatching is consistent, right? The viewer is going to be tricked into thinking that they're not looking at lines, but looking at different grades of value. Okay, that's layer one. Now I'm going to separate out my light from the rest of the lightest light, change the angle. Now we're going to start establishing the halftone, change the angle. And the more layers you put down, the more even the hatching becomes. Right? So some areas where you accidentally put down a line of the same direction, no longer visible, right? No longer such a big deal. Once again, now that I've got a little bit of value distinction here, I can see that the shadows need to go a little bit darker. Let's go and switch my pencil. My pen. Okay. And think about where things need to go a little bit darker. Again, in this case, you don't really have to worry too much about repeating your angles. Particularly once you start going darker, it's not going to matter quite as much. So you can switch your angles if you want. Okay, let's go a little bit darker here.
Again, keeping the line straight, not cross contouring. Okay, there you have it, an example of using hatching to indicate value, the value hatch method. Very common. You see lots of illustrators, fine artists using it. The most famous, I think, is an artist that died a couple years ago, David Levine, who did illustrations for the New York Review of Books. Really well done, well executed pen and ink drawings of writers, intellectuals. So I'll show you some examples of that. The value hatch, another very useful method, and also good training to set yourself up for the most difficult rendering method, the contour hatch, where we're going to be not only changing angles, but responding to the form that we're trying to render. Okay, now let's talk about the last and most difficult hatching method called the contour hatch. The added complication here is now I'm going to change angles, but I also want to make sure that my strokes contour, cross-contour the form that I'm representing. So in this case, because we're dealing with something that's round, I want to make sure that my hatching is not straight, but actually curving this way. So ideally, if I'm rendering a round form, not a single hatch mark is going to be perfectly straight, right? It's going to curve. Once again, I've indicated my light break. I've indicated the location of my highlight, the shape of my cast shadow, and I'm going to start shading by putting down a value that represents the core shadow. You can start with any angle you want, really, but in this case, your hatching needs to curve like this. It's going to curve, it's going to curve, it's going to curve. It's curving because we're dealing with round forms. Okay, now I'm going to put down the body shadow. I'm going to change my angle. Again, you can always rotate your paper. And then I want to make sure that A, I push my hatching past my core shadow to create a halftone, and B, I want to make sure that that hatch mark is curving. Again, pay attention to the line density. Pay attention to line density so that the width between the lines stays more or less consistent. Notice that I'm curving my lines here. Curving, curving, curving. Okay, so they're changing angles, not a big deal. I'm going to put down the body shadow. Again, it really helps to rotate your paper. And I'm making sure that the strokes contour. So again, in this case, not only am I paying attention to the value, I'm also trying to use those lines to carve the form, to reinforce the form. All right, let's change the angle. I'm going to go back in and reinforce the shape of my core shadow. So I'm thinking about value and also how these lines are cross-contouring the spherical form here. Okay, we need a little bit more density in the shadow, so let's do that. A little more value in the shadow. Let's do that. Let's make the core shadow a little bit stronger. Again, always make sure in this case that your lines are curving. Never put down a straight line. you can see that because the lines are reinforcing the form, this gives me the strongest three-dimensional effect of any of these. Right? Okay, so let's push the core shadow a little bit. I think this pen needs to be flushed out. I think this ink is clogged the pen a little bit. I guess I'll have to do that after the demo. Okay, so just pushing my halftone a little bit. And then once again, curving the line to reinforce the form. Okay, so depending on the degree of finish, this could be enough. So again, quite often you'll see pen and ink drawings where the artist has dealt with the shadows and left the lights alone. However, if I want to add a little bit more value, let's move the highlight over a little bit, should be over here. Let's switch pens and go into the lights and do exactly the same thing. Again, notice I'm cross-contouring the forms here. Again, the actual direction of the stroke is not particularly important so long as the strokes are curving. And so long as the angle keeps shifting. Right? So I can change the angles here. Let's introduce a little bit more halftone here. But really, what we should be doing here is separating out our highlights from the rest of the lights. Okay, so we've got the highlight established. Now let's start going in and separating out the lights from the lightest light. Right, so the lightest light is here, and then we have a general lighter area. Let's do that. Again, notice that I'm curving my lines all the time. Right, every single line is curved. So again, this is tricky. Every time I'm putting down a layer of hatch, I am changing the angle and making sure that I'm not repeating the angle as much as possible. But after you achieve a certain density, it's going to be impossible not to repeat an angle. Not important. Just make sure that you keep your lines curving. All right, you're following the form here. I'm curving along the contour of the sphere. So once again, you'll see that once you've added a little bit of the light, you'll see that the shadow is going to need some adjustment. Let's do that. Trying not to repeat the angle, but once you have a certain number of directions, it's going to be impossible. Building up the core shadow again. Okay, we forgot about the cast shadow. Let's do our cast shadow. Now, the cast shadow, because it's sitting on a flat plane, needs to be rendered with straight lines. Right, that's going to be very important. Right, if you start curving the lines, that's going to indicate that we're dealing with some kind of curved shape. That's going to make the cast shadow lift up, not feel flat, not feel like it's sitting on a flat surface. Again, this pen is skipping a little bit. It's not cooperating. Probably needs to be cleaned out. Lesson here is I'm using a waterproof ink in here, Noodler's Waterproof Black. Whenever you do, you can't let the pens sit for long periods of time. They need to be constantly used and cleaned out every once in a while because waterproof ink is going to gunk up the works in your fountain pen a little bit. So I recommend not using waterproof ink on pens that you aren't using all the time, and then cleaning it out frequently, flushing it out, getting a pen flush to clean the pen. Or you'll experience problems like what I'm having. Okay, so here's a third method, also very commonly used in illustration, in fine art. Most common old master to use this type of technique is Albert Dürer. So I'll give you an example of an Albert Dürer drawing using this cross contour technique. Now, there are other methods. There are other ways of cross hatching. There are hybrid methods where the artist might begin with value hatching and then switch to cross contour hatching, or a combination of single direction with contour hatch. Sometimes different hatching techniques are used in different parts of the drawing. So quite often you'll see the area of focus, let's say a figure, rendered with the value hatch and then the background, because this method of hatching is a little bit softer, will be used for background elements. So quite often you'll find that artists are going to be using a number of different techniques in a single drawing to create the effects that they want.